Hi there, welcome to another video training session brought to you by Epic Games. In this video, we're going to show you how to create a hover component that you can just attach to any static mesh that you like and make it hover in your scene. So here's an example. I'm just going to go into my starter content and I've got some shapes. We'll bring in this little pyramid shape and I'll drag it up into the air. I'll then take its mobility and switch it over to movable. That's an important part, as you will see when we kind of get going here. I'll go into my components, and here's an example of what we're gonna be building. I'm just gonna drag this right onto the component list of my selected static mesh. So now, all I have to do is hit play, and my pyramid is hovering. In fact, I can bop it around the scene, and you see it continues to hover. So now that we know what we're going to be building, let's get to work. Let's make something. So I'm going to right click here in my content browser. Now you'll notice I have created a folder specifically called components. If you don't have this for some reason, you could go under your blueprints folder. You could right click and make a new folder and create one yourself. But I'm going to jump right inside, right click and create a new blueprint class. Now we have a lot of different parent classes to choose from. What we want is a scene component. That's a component that has its own relative location, relative to the object. So we'll click on that and we will call this the hover component, like so. Now once you've got that, double click on it and that'll open it up here inside the blueprint editor. Now you're gonna see a couple of events that are disabled. They're just kind of sitting there waiting for you to do things to them. We have initialize and we have tick. We're gonna start with initialize component, and what we need to do here is get a reference to the main primitive component that's applied to our object. Now, a primitive component is any component that we can apply physics to, such as a static mesh. So let's right click and we will start by getting the owner. And what this is, the owner is the object to which our hover component has been attached. We'll drag a wire out from this and let's say get all components, or I'm sorry, let's say, let me just type components, do it right the first time. Because what I'm looking for is get components by class, and for some reason I thought it was get all components in my head somewhere. Now we can choose the type of component class we're looking for, and what we're looking for specifically is a primitive component. As I mentioned, that is a component that can have physics applied to it. Now that's going to return an array, which is a list of all potential primitive components on our object. We're going to drag a wire out from this and choose a get, and leave the get set to zero. That's literally the same thing as saying get whatever the first thing is on your list, because whatever it is, that should be good enough. Now once we have that, let's right click and promote this to a variable, and we're gonna call this variable primitive component. And the reason we set it to a variable is so that we don't have to go through and create all these nodes anytime we wanna talk to this object. So cool, now we've got that stored. The last thing we want to do is go ahead and tell that primitive component to simulate physics. So choose set simulate physics and check the little checkbox to set that to true. Okay, so at this point, if we wanted to, we could compile, save, because that's a good habit, and then we could test this. So here's how we're going to test it. I'm going to delete out this static mesh we had in the scene a moment ago. Let's go under the shapes folder, and I'll bring in a torus, because the idea of a floating donut amuses me to no end. And we'll go under our components. Here's our hover component, and I'm just going to drag that onto our components list. Also, remember to select the object itself and make sure its mobility is set to movable. If you don't do this, you will get errors. It's not a big deal. You can just hit stop and set it to movable and try again. Now, we haven't set up any hoverability right now. As a reminder, all we've done up to this point is we've just told it to simulate physics, but this is a great way to test and see if we've got something started. If I simulate, this object should fall to the ground, and it does, which is perfect. Okay, so now with that, we can start setting up the hover behavior. That's going to happen based off of tick. Tick is an event that is called on every single frame, and what we're going to do on every single frame is start by looking straight down from the location of our object. We're going to do that with a line trace. So drag a wire out from tick and type line trace by channel, and the channel we're going to use is visibility. So basically, look in the direction I tell you to and see if you find anything that is visible. Now, we need to supply a start and an end for this. The start is easy. For the start, we can just use the world location of our component. So this is going to be the world location of the hover component itself. So we'll go ahead and just drag that, plug that right into start. Easy peasy, no problem. Now for end, what we want to do is look 150 units straight down from wherever we started. So we can take this same world location, and let's hit the minus key, and we're going to choose vector minus vector. Like so. Now, right click on this second pin here and choose split struct pin, and that's going to give you input access to X, Y, and Z, which is really handy and one of my favorite little additions to Blueprint. So let's set Z to 150. My apologies if I flip back and forth between Z and Z. And we can plug that, and that becomes the endpoint. So what we're doing, just as a kind of a refresher, is we're drawing a line straight down 150 units from the location of our component relative to the object. Now, I want to be able to change that value. Right now, this is kind of hard-coded. It's set to 150. I'm going to right-click on that pin and choose Promote to Variable, and we will call this Trace Length. Now, because I set the value first, if we take a look, if I compile this blueprint and then select trace length, notice its default value is already set to 150. I use that trick a lot. I will set a value and then promote it to a variable so I don't have to go set its default later. Okay, so now we're doing our trace, and we don't want to perform any kind of hover logic or any sort of hover working unless the trace happens to hit something. So we'll start by dragging a wire out from the return value and connect that to a branch. Now everything else we do will be plugged into true, and nothing will be connected to false. That means if this trace doesn't hit anything, we don't do anything, which will keep this relatively nice and simple. Now, what we're going to do from here involves a little bit of vector math. Don't be frightened, it's all pretty straightforward. We'll start by taking the out hit. This is whatever that trace happened to hit, the point in space that we happened to hit, and if we break this up, there's all kinds of data stored in here. We have the hit location, we have the normal, which is the direction that the surface that we hit was facing, we can tell what kind of material was applied to it, all kinds of fun stuff if we want to. Now, let's start simply. What we're gonna do is take the location of the hit, and we are going to subtract from that. So we'll do vector minus vector, and we're going to, once again, get the world location of our component. By subtracting the two, what we've done is we've kind of theoretically drawn a line from the point we hit back to the location of our object. Really, this is just a way that we're going to use to calculate the distance. If we drag a wire out from the results of this subtract and just type out length, you'll see vector length. This number literally represents how far away our component is from whatever it happened to hit. And that's going to be an important thing, because if we take this value, we can now divide it, float divided by float, and we'll divide it by that trace length. Now, what this will do is this will give us a value that, for all intents and purposes, will be between 0 and 1, where we will achieve a value of 0 if the hit distance is 0 units away, or basically right on top of the location of our component. And then as we get closer to trace length, we'll blend out to 1. So, because we'd have like 150 divided by 150, which of course is 1. So now that we have a 0 to 1 value, we're going to do a linear interpolation. Or you could just type lerp for short, which is going to be a lot easier. So choose float lerp. And we're going to take our end result and plug that into alpha. Again, this node here is resulting in a 0 to 1 value, and that's perfect to drive the alpha of a lerp. Now, a lerp is going to blend between two values given a 0 to 1 alpha. Now, what we want is when our object, when it's hovering really close to the ground, we want a lot of force. When it gets farther away, we want that force to bleed off to 0. So we'll start with a value at A, which will be that'll be at 0, so that's what will happen if we're really close to the ground. And we're going to set that to 500,000, or 500,000. That's the amount of force. We'll go ahead and leave B at 0. And what that means is, if we are more than 150 units away from the ground, well, we're not applying any force at all, which is exactly what we want. So the next thing we want to do, though, is change the direction of our force based off of the direction of the ground. So if we put this, if we drop this object and it's hovering on a ramp, we want it to kind of slide down the ramp. To do that, we will take the impact normal, we'll drag a wire out, and we will multiply it by a float. And we're going to end up multiplying it by the result of this force amount that we've just calculated. Okay, so now that we have all of that, Let's go over and just apply our force. This is where things start to get really easy. We'll grab our primitive component that we set up earlier, and we'll drag a wire off of that, and let's just say, just type in force. Yes, and it may it always be with you. And we will drag the true wire over and plug that in like so. And now we can just take our end result of what we calculated, and that becomes our force. We could actually test this again right now, so let's hit compile. Let's hit save so we don't lose any of our work, and then let's simulate. And check it out, our object is hovering. But it's hovering really quick. As a matter of fact, it looks like it's steadily accumulating velocity, and it's bouncing higher and higher, which is awesome, by the way. I love it. But it's not super useful. So let's jump back into our hover component for just a moment. Let's take our primitive component variable, and we'll hit Control-C to copy it, Control-V to paste it back in, which we don't have to do. We could just drag a wire out, but I'm trying to keep this nice and neat. We'll drag a wire out from this one, and we will set the linear damping value. Linear damping is a way that we can slow this object down as it moves through space so it doesn't kind of move quite so quickly. And we're going to set this to a value of 1, which is really going to slow the object down. Now, let's go ahead and just copy this off again, and we'll drag one more wire out, and we're also going to apply some angular damping, which does the same thing as linear, but for rotation, so the object can start spinning really, really fast. And we'll set this to a value of about 0.6. Now, again, we could test this, but before we do, let's go ahead and kind of wrap things up. So we've got some values here that obviously it would be nice to have some customizability, like the amount of force that we're applying here when we get really, really close to the ground. It would be nice if that was variable, if we could change that. So let's take A, we'll right click on it, and choose promote to variable, and we'll call this hover force. Now, same thing with linear damping. We may want to change that later on down the road. So let's right click again, promote to variable. We'll call this linear damping. And I'll move that around and make it nice and clean. And one more time for angular damping as well. So we'll promote that and type in angular damping. And there we are. Now, last thing, and this is just for a lot of extra customizability. Take your trace length, your hover force, your linear damping, and your angular damping, and click this little eyeball icon on the right-hand side. That will make all of these editable. And the reason we do that is so that now, if we take a look at our object and we select the hover component here in the component list, we now have access to all of those values right here inside the details panel. And that's super cool because now we can just hit simulate, and our object is hovering. If we select it, we can now go right to that hover component that we've just created, and we can start making tweaks. So we could take like our trace length and pull it down. You see our object gets a lot lower to the ground. We could take our hover force and make it a lot lower. So now you can see he's kind of slowing down a little bit. Or maybe take the linear damping and kick that up. So now he's slowing down and he's like not moving anymore. And now that we've tweaked that out, we kind of have an idea of the values we like. Of course, I think we just lost those because we stopped simulating, but that's totally cool. Let me test something real quick. Let's go ahead and select our objects, go to hover. Let's pull our trace length down, and it's doing something like that. And if I hit K, I don't think this does what I want it to, but I'm gonna check anyway. Oh, it did actually, it saved that. So you can use the K key to save those values that you change while you're simulating, which is super helpful. So be sure to use that to your advantage as well. So I guess with that, the last thing we could do is just kind of prove that this whole thing worked, run up and bounce into this object. And then we could apply it to other objects as well. So we could come in here, maybe grab a couple more shapes, like maybe this sphere, and we'll move it up into the air. Make sure you set mobility to movable. Don't forget that. And let's do a capsule as well. And we'll rotate it kind of off to the side. Same thing, make sure you set it to movable. And then we'll go back to our components, and here's our hover component. We'll drag it on. And over on our sphere, we'll do the same thing. We'll just make sure that we have the sphere selected. Excuse me, there we go. And drag that on like so. And let's just simulate again, see what happens. And everything is hovering, it's amazing. So there you go, you've seen how to create a reusable hover component that you can attach to anything that you want, any static mesh that you want to make it hover in your scene. That's gonna wrap things up for this video. Thanks so much for watching.